I call this climate change triumph and tragedy in Paris, and I'm going to try and focus on both of those. Were any of you here at the Paris negotiations? So, I'm going to try and pull together some of the things from that. If anything's not clear as I'm going through, please feel free just to, you know, just to call out, and if there's any sort of point of clarification, then we can discuss some of this towards the end. The presentation, I'm going to start off with a quote from Richard Feynman, who you're probably all reasonably familiar with. I'm going to make a provocation, and it, you know, please note it is a provocation. And it's particularly aimed, I've used this before, it's particularly aimed at the integrated assessment modelling community. So when they use the word modelling, or even climate modelling, I'm not particularly talking about the climate modellers, the physical climate modellers. I'm talking about this other particular group who bring a lot of economics into their modelling process as well. But the provocation really aimed at them, but partly aimed at all of us who are involved in climate change. I'm going to touch on my hypothesis and conclusion, because normally people say that my work is very depressing, so I'm going to try and give the upbeat conclusion. What was Paris about? Say something about the emission pathways that we need to be on to deliver 2 degrees C. Talk about some carbon budgets and some basic arithmetic around that. Then focusing on energy demand, which is the area I do a lot of work on energy particularly, but a significant interest in the demand side, and then some closing comments and reflections. So let's start off with this quote from Richard Feynman. And he was the shuttle, I mean, obviously you'll know him as the famous 20th century physicist, perhaps one of the most famous and most useful contributions in 20th century physics. But this relates to him as the president of the Shuttle Commission, looking into the accidents and the Challenger. For a successful technology, reality must take precedence over public relations, for nature cannot be fooled. And for those of you that are aware of what happened in the Challenger accident, he's talking there that the PR, the economists, the senior people involved were happy to overlook the fact is that there were concerns by some of the engineers doing the work that the O-ring seal was not going to be adequate to hold in the fuel. So he was talking about, at the end of the day, yeah, it's the science that matters, not the PR or the economics. And I think that's something we can think about in relation to climate change, and I'll come back to that later on. My provocation is, and as I said before, risk of the wrath of people who might think I'm aiming at specifically at them, I mean this really at all the climate change community, but particularly these integrated assessment modellers who feed into Paris and feed into government policies. In developing 2 degrees C emission scenarios, we apply questionable assumptions and fine-tune our analysis to align with political and economic sensibilities. Now, I'm not saying we fiddle the data, but by fine-tuning our assumptions, we can move things in a direction that are in line with what our political paymasters wanted to hear. And I'll try to show how we have repeatedly done that for a long time on climate change. This sounds slightly flippant, but it's not meant to be, and again, I'll try to outline why I'm saying this later on. Time travel and negative emission technologies are two such examples of where we attune our findings or our assumptions to ensure our findings are in line with a dominant paradigm. Why have we capitulated? If my arguments are sound, why have we as a community capitulated? In 2016, the carbon budgets for 2 degrees centigrade, same below it, can no longer be addressed within our current political and economic paradigm. So we cannot hold to the budgets from the IPCC to 2 degrees centigrade within our current economic and political framing. We could have done it if we started to do something about climate change in 1990, but we're in 2016 and the budgets are very small indeed. Instead, our ongoing prolonged failure on climate change means that the 2 degrees C carbon budgets, to which we are all signatory as members of democracy that signed up to the Paris Agreement, is now a challenge for our political and economic framing. And I think that simply comes out of the maths, and I'll try to show that as we go along. Okay. So it's the political repercussions of the science, or implications of the science, that lead me to that conclusion. We have collectively been very scared, almost the opposite of what a lot of the skeptics have argued. We've been scared to voice the outcome. We have underplayed this situation. We have not overplayed it. We have done almost the 180 degree reverse of what the skeptics have argued. And I would argue, again, in a provocative sense, instead of developing and contributing to evidence-based policy, what we have developed is policy-based science. So we have adjusted our analysis in a way that is, again, as I said before, fits with what the policymakers, our paymasters, want to hear. Someone else referred to it this afternoon as funding-based science. You know, we adjust our science to fit with what the funding regimes want. And I think there's something in that. Our funding regimes now, at least for the UK, are far too close to government. Traditionally, they've always been at arm's length. That is no longer the case in the UK. I don't know what it's like in Ireland. We've accepted that finance and economics, and I do draw a distinction between those that may come out during the talk, we've accepted that finance and economics trumps physics. And the point I've been making while I've been here is that we've had physics for 13 billion years or so, since the Big Bang, and it's proved fairly successful. We've had our current economic framework probably for a few decades, really, at most. And it's already coming up against the buffers, not relating to climate change, in relation to its own remit. We just see what's happening globally in terms of the economic system around the world, and we see there are problems with it. So I think at the end of the day, my money is on physics trumping, and the second law of thermodynamics trumping our current ephemeral economic framework. My headline conclusion to finish with something positive is that I think we can still avoid a 2 degrees C framing of dangerous climate change. And let's be clear, I'm not suggesting that 2 degrees C is safe. 2 degrees C will kill many people around the planet. They'll be poor, they'll be low emitters, they haven't caused a problem, they'll be non-white, typically, and a long way from here. So there's a very clear group of people who will be impacted at 2 degrees centigrade, which is why, of course, in Paris, they were arguing for 1.5 degrees C temperature increase rather than 2. But I think we have only just now an outside chance of holding to 2 degrees centigrade. I don't think we have a good chance any longer of that. I think we've blown that good chance. And the final line here relates it to actually the economic framing of society. I think actually you can avoid dangerous climate change or the 2 degrees C framing in line with economics as it was originally defined. It comes from the Greek root oikonomia, the stewardship of the household, the prudent use of resources. There's no reference to money in the original form of economics. It's only when it was co-opted, or when it was changed into the modern non-contextual mathematical form of economics, went from political economy into what we now have, marginal neoclassical economics. And it moved actually from oikonomia to krematistics, defined variously as the acquisition of wealth, the making of money. So it's abstract from the physical nature of the world within which we live. That's the modern form of economics that we have. And I think that that form of economics is incompatible with dealing with climate change, but the original form, political economy, prudent use of resources, is in line. And I think we need to go back to thinking about that way of looking at economics. And you know, I'm not just saying that, many people have been saying that, but it's Stiglitz, Piketty, even the Pope. You know, many people have been pointing in that sort of direction for some time. To deliver on 2 degrees centigrade, and this is the bit that's really very challenging, and I'll come back to this as I go through the talk, we need to deliver deep reductions in energy demand, and that's the bit that is politically challenging. So huge reductions in energy demand, and the question we normally get, and as an engineer who primarily worked in my industrial background on large bits of engineering kit for supplying energy, I think it's a bit of a shame that we cannot deliver it through energy supply. Wind, solar, hydro, nuclear are all low carbon. And biofuels can be low carbon, but sometimes isn't.
But all the others are very low carbon, 5 to 15 grams of carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour, typically. But in 2016, the reason we can't deliver it with energy supply, or at least only with energy supply, is about timing. We have to move away from this idea that 2050 matters, or even 2030. It's the carbon budgets that matter when it comes to the science. And carbon budgets are what frame my discussion here. And it's carbon budgets that come out of the science, not some spurious 2050 target that we have, for instance, in the UK. So does Paris help or hinder this framing of climate change based on the sort of budget framing of the issues from the IPCC? Well, before we start to think about Paris, what was the backdrop to going into it? And if you can see, but there's a sort of a faint figure behind this slide, which is just the carbon dioxide emissions rising up, which have been exponential. The last year or two have broadly stabilised, and we can just talk about that. I think it's unlikely to be a long-term stabilisation. So that's where they've been going. The mitigation message, the emission reduction message, was fully outlined really in the first IPCC report in 1990, a quarter of a century ago. A quarter of a century ago. Just think about how long that is. Some of you here are not that old. Well, maybe you are, but you won't remember much from that long ago anyway, put it that way. A quarter of a century. And during your lives, people like me, grey-haired, usually men, and no-haired people, have done nothing about climate change. So we have failed you, and that's something we should be honest and clear about that. And we are handing you a fairly poisoned chalice, I think it would be fair to say. The emissions this year, 25 years on from when we had all that information and when we first pretended to care about climate change, will be 60% higher than they were in 1990. So that's what we're handing on for this year, 60% higher. That's a measure of our success in keeping emissions down, a 60% rise. The carbon dioxide in the atmosphere this year will be higher than it has been, or already is higher, than it has been for 800,000 years, possibly 5 to 20 million years. But certainly for 800,000 years, three times longer than our species has been on the planet. The CO2 concentration is that much higher. So when we went into Paris, that was the backdrop against which the Paris negotiations had to be evolved, had to evolve. The Paris document, and there were three versions of it during the week. The first version with lots and lots of brackets, all the red lines from the different countries. Then the penultimate text that came out on the Thursday evening. Was it the Thursday evening? I think it was. Those that were there? I think it was the Thursday evening. And then obviously the final version. So there were three versions of it without brackets, obviously, in the final one. And I think it is important to say, and I mean this, wholeheartedly. I'm not trying to just play up a positive thing about Paris. I think it had two very significant triumphs. The first of those is that I think it pretty much pulled the rug from underneath the denialists and probably most of the skeptics, at least some of the skeptics. All the world leaders came together and said, we broadly accept the science of climate change. That hadn't happened before. I think that is a huge triumph that all the leaders say that they need to develop their policies in their home countries in relation to climate change on the basis of the science that they all think is appropriate for informing their policies. The second triumph that I'm going to talk about, and there are lots of other, let's call them smaller triumphs throughout the document that people this week have been pointing out to me, but I can't go through them all, but from a mitigation point of view, the other major triumph to me is this particular paragraph here, which I will blow up so you can read it. Hold the increase in average global temperature to well below 2 degrees centigrade, well below, not a 50-50 chance of, well below 2 degrees centigrade above pre-industrial levels, and to pursue efforts along the lines of 1.5 degrees centigrade. That is a very clear quantitative steer. And the other thing that is really important, it then said to make that steer within our countries, within Ireland, for instance, in accordance with the best science. And I would argue probably the best science at any one time reasonably is going to be captured by the IPCC. It's an inevitably conservative process. There are lots of things that are not factored in to the headline messages, but they're often well covered within the main text of the report. But that, I think, is the best science that we have. And also on the basis of equity. In other words, poorer parts of the world will be able to peak their emissions later than the wealthy parts of the world and should be given more leeway in reducing their emissions in terms of time. And obviously also to eradicate poverty. So this second triumph I see related to well below 2 degrees C, or 1.5 degrees C as well. Based on the best science, that gives us very clear carbon budgets. And then also the emphasis on equity, which tells us a little bit about what we need to do in our particular countries, particularly the wealthier parts of the world. If you put all of those together, this is a very clear steer against which to assess the policies of our respective governments around the globe. Are they in line with this? If not, it is the role of civil society to ask the policymakers why they're not in line with what our leaders have signed up to. So there's a very clear move or opportunity here for quantitatively assessing the policies of our leaders. Not just the leaders of our governments, but those in companies, the VCs of universities, and even perhaps our own lives. So right across the board, this helps us understand the scale of the challenge quantitatively. There are some issues with the Paris Agreement that weren't covered that I think are really important, and I think it really ideally should have been in there. It's a 32-page document on climate change, and there's no reference to fossil fuels throughout the 32 pages that are there, or any reference to decarbonisation. Now, this is the problem of trying to have a compromise with all the world's countries on board. As I understand it, and I wasn't party to the detailed discussions, but what leaked out was that, for instance, and there will be many other occasions of this for other countries, but the Saudis, in this case, would not sign a document with fossil fuels in it. So fossil fuels were removed. No decarbonisation in there, no reference to aviation and shipping. The emissions from those two sectors are the equivalent of the UK and Germany added together and are growing at very rapid rates, and both sectors think they'll at least double by 2050. In the UK, they represent about 14 to 15% of UK's carbon dioxide emissions, 14 to 15%, and no one accounts for them. They're not included in our national inventories. They're only in a memo that we may attach when we hand it on to the UNFCCC. The voluntary pledges, the INDCs that we all submitted, if you add them together, they're often said to refer to a link to a 2.7 degrees C warming. I think that is misleading. That assumes a lot of significant optimism from the people that have made that assessment in terms of what happens post 2030. The INDCs, the pledges, only go up to 2030, really only from 2020 to 2030. And there are some conditional criteria from some of the countries. They don't all have absolute emission reductions. Some of them are carbon intensity reductions. They have different baselines. They're a bit of a muddled mess. But they're still much better than nothing. But I think that they are much, much more in line with a 3 to 3.5 degrees C of warming than they are with 2.7. It's also, and I've already told, actually pointed out to me today, that's a mistake, that should be 2023. The INDCs are not going to be reviewed for some considerable period of time. So our pledges that already are for well above 2 degrees centigrade will not be reviewed until, well, it's going to be well above 200 billion tonnes. It's going to be somewhere in the region of 300 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide from now. So, you know, that's how long we're going to wait before we review the pledges that are already well above our 2 degree C framing. 300 billion tonnes, by the way, is probably a third of the budget that we have left for a reasonable chance of 2 degrees centigrade. A third of the budget before we even get around to reviewing the INDCs. And the other one, which I'm going to talk about a lot later on during the presentation, is that we are completely reliant on negative emission technologies that do not exist at the moment. And they're not referenced anywhere in the report. And indeed, they're not referenced in the government, the UK government's, or the Committee on Climate Change advice in the UK to the government in their fifth budget report, where they are again reliant on these technologies. And the only reference in a fairly detailed report is one footnote in a much smaller text than the rest that refers to BECCS, and which again I'll come back to. So we are always hiding this technology in our reports and our guidance to government. Again, that is part of the idea of fine-tuning and massaging our assumptions to fit with a political dogma. Before Paris, we were aiming somewhere in this direction. I think we have to be careful to add too much precision on exactly where we're heading. The IEA, Fatty Bill from the IEA, had said that we were aiming towards 6 degrees C. We were on something like an A1FI RCP 8.5 type scenario, so we were very high emissions. That, of course, would come off thanks to the collapse of the global economy, so we were starting to come off that by 2008 to 2010. But what we signed up to in Paris was something moving away from that business-as-usual model, somewhere around about 3.5 degrees centigrade rise. But let's think about that. When we build buildings like this one here, I didn't check the date on this one, but 1750, something like that. Is that about right? This building will probably be here for another 200 years. So when we build buildings, we use them for centuries sometimes, unless they're built by some of the current housing companies. When we build infrastructures, sewage networks, gas networks, and so forth, we use those for years. In the UK, we're still using the town gas network. When we put up, I'll say buildings already, power stations, 25 to 50 years, ships and aircraft, something similar. So we're talking about very long lock-in periods of very high carbon infrastructures. So the policies we put in place today are not about today, but are about our emissions for the coming decades and centuries. So every single time a pen is put to paper by a government official or by anyone else that's involved with developing our current society, we are locking in, or we're doing something about the carbon emissions for the future. We have to bear that in mind. Now, are these sort of realistic, these sorts of assumptions we're making about a rise in emissions? Well, I'm going to look at the UK here, and please notice the question mark. The UK likes to see itself as a leading nation on climate change. Actually, I'm not quite sure that's true anymore. I'm not sure the current administration is particularly worried about climate change or even necessarily its reputation. But historically, the UK has had a reputation of trying to lead on climate change. Whether we think that's justified or not is a judgment you can all make. So I'm going to focus in here. What has it done? It's now given tax breaks to shale gas. Shale gas is natural gas with slightly higher volatile organic compounds. Natural gas, CH4, is 75% carbon, only 25% hydrogen. So when you burn 75% carbon, what you get is lots of carbon dioxide. It is not low carbon, it is very high carbon. Gas is a very high carbon energy source. And we give them tax breaks to that. The Chancellor is planning to build 30 new gas-fired power stations without any carbon capture and storage, which of course we've relied on anyway. We had the highest ever investment in North Sewell oil and gas in 2012 and 13. We're expanding aviation and ports, two sectors that are incredibly difficult to decarbonise, particularly the first of those. We're systematically dismantling our support for renewables in the UK. We've reneged on our carbon capture and storage commitments that were in the Conservative manifesto. We have now pulled back on the Peterhead and the White Rose plans for carbon capture and storage. And we've opened a consulate in Alberta next door to the tar sands so we can sell our expertise from the North Sea into pulling out the tar sands that makes coal look clean. This is a leading nation on climate change. Now, I guess that you're not much different in Ireland or in Norway or the rest of the EU. We're all doing this and all deluding ourselves that we're on anything like a pathway towards 2 degrees centigrade. So what about 2 degrees C? So this is an outside chance of 2 degrees C. This is the 33% chance of 2 degrees C taken from the IPCC synthesis report, table 2.2. But the bit that I was talking about earlier is that in this first stage here, that is too early for energy supply. You cannot build the supply fast enough. And you get lots of particularly technical engineering advocates saying, well, we can build our way out of this. Just look at the time frame. You cannot do it. And I've taken the slides out of this today, but if you're trying to do it with nuclear power or wind power or solar power or any of those things, remember they only provide electricity, which is only 20% of the energy we consume. There's the other 80%, which we'd have to make low carbon, probably have to electrify most of that. All of that will take several decades, even if we had a coordinated Marshall Plan. So we have to do something about reducing our demand. We have to have deep cuts in energy demand. Now that's starting to sound political. But I don't think there's any way out of that if you want to abide by the political commitments on 2 degrees centigrade. The supply side is important. Well, not important, it's essential. Without reducing our emissions from energy supply, we're going to fail on 2 degrees centigrade. But it is essential but not sufficient. We have to have both cuts in demand and dramatic increase in a low carbon, in fact, zero carbon energy supply. But this is all based on a global assessment, not on a regional assessment. So it's actually hard to pull policies out of this. And we are signed up here to do everything on climate change on the basis of equity. So let's try and unpick this and say, what would that mean for the UK? What would that mean for Ireland, for the EU, for the US and wealthier parts of the world? So let's go back to the carbon budget from the IPCC. I'm not going to go through this in any detail, but you get lots of tables like this. This is the one I typically use, table 2.2 from the synthesis report. You could use the paper that came out from Miles Allen and others in Nature Climate Change, I think last week or two, when they're reviewing some of these budgets. But these are good enough for making any assessment of what we need to do from a policy perspective. If you look at these in detail, what it tells us is that to stay below 2 degrees centigrade, and there are different temperatures you can choose here, but for 2 degrees C, we have a range of probabilities. And I think that is interesting to start off with. 2 degrees C, as we all know, I presume you all know, is not a safe threshold. As I've said before, for many people around the world in climatically vulnerable parts, it is a very dangerous threshold. But the probabilities of avoiding it, none of those are particularly high, are they? A 66% chance of avoiding something very dangerous. You know, none of us would accept that in our lives, in driving a car, in flying a plane. You know, so nowhere in our lives would we accept that for something that was very dangerous. And yet here, we're playing with the planet, not even just with a car journey or a plane journey. But from that, we also get a range of carbon budgets. So we know how much carbon dioxide we can emit in the atmosphere for different probabilities of 2 degrees centigrade. And I'm not going to go into the details here, but it's interesting to note in the synthesis report, despite it coming out in November 2014, the carbon budgets are from 2011. And if ever you're doing any maths around that, we've emitted about 150 billion tonnes of CO2 since 2011. The point I'm trying to say from that table before is that we can say very clearly we can no longer achieve 1.5 degrees C temperature threshold. That is gone. That will have gone by 2020, 2023. So by the time we review our pledges, we'll have used up all of the carbon budget for the 1.5 degrees C temperature threshold, according to the IPCC, given the fact that we emit 36 billion tonnes of CO2 from energy and 40 billion tonnes of CO2 in total at the moment. So 1.5 degrees C, no chance. Why was it in there? It was in there, if we were really honest about this, a sop to the poorer parts of the world, to salve our conscience. That's why we had it in there, which is quite a sad indictment of our real concern for other people on the planet. For 2 degrees centigrade, 66% chance of that temperature has gone. We've lost that opportunity now. We cannot hold the 66% chance. A 50% chance, if you look at the carbon budget, would require a warlike footing. And I've already asked here in Ireland, was climate change the forefront of the recent elections? No, no one thought it was here either. It's not in the UK, over the EU, and I doubt it will be in any of the elections and discussions in the near future. So none of us see climate change. Even if we work on it on a day-to-day basis, we don't see it like that. We don't see it as that serious an issue as yet. So that's a 50% budget blown. All we've got left now, and we've just got it, is an outside chance of 2 degrees centigrade, an outside chance of avoiding something that is very dangerous, having already blown, chosen to blow, the budget for 1.5 degrees C. So what's this mean for poorer and what's it mean for richer countries? And ultimately, at the end of the day, for our policymakers, we want to know what's it mean for Ireland, what's it mean for the UK. So we're trying to sort of tease out from the quantification at a global level what that might mean for us. Well, a simple method here, without any fancy integrated assessment modelling approach, just simple arithmetic. We have a carbon budget for a 33% chance of 2 degrees centigrade taken from the IPCC. We can make certain estimates about the emissions from the poorer parts of the world in relation to when their emissions peak and then the rate of reduction that they come down from that peak. And therefore, we can work out their carbon budget. We subtract 2 from 1 and we have the carbon budget left for the wealthy parts of the world. So fairly non-controversial bit of arithmetic. Let's assume that the poorer parts of the world, the industrializing parts of the world, which are dominated by China here from an emissions perspective, that they can collectively peak their emissions by 2025. Their emissions will stop going up by 2025. I think that is viable. None of them thought it was viable in Paris. They all think it's 2030 for China, 2040 for India and beyond. But I think China's emissions could easily peak by 2025, possibly even earlier. So I think that is doable, but challenging. And there's a recent LSE report suggesting that seems to be something that is viable. But the next part is way beyond what anyone is talking about at the moment. Let's imagine then that they could achieve a mitigation rate of 10% per annum. Now that's an absolute mitigation rate. So their economies are growing at 6% per annum, that's a 16% reduction or improvement in carbon intensity every single year, year on year. Remember, this is for an outside chance of 2 degrees C, I'm looking at this. They would have to fully decarbonize their energy system by 2050. That's planes, trains, ships, everything by 2050. We can work out the carbon budget from that, fairly straightforward to do. And you can take it off the carbon budget that we have from the IPCC for 2 degrees centigrade. You can take the full range if you want to, right across the climate sensitivity range. It won't make much difference to results. And you end up with something, and actually it would be higher than this. This is slightly out of date now. We're looking at where we are in the process of redoing this. About a 10% reduction in emissions year on year for the wealthy parts of the world, for an outside chance of 2 degrees centigrade. This is just IPCC science and numbers and arithmetic. That's all it requires here. That's the equivalent to a 50, so I don't know what Ireland's target is for 2020, but you'd have to have a 50% cut in Ireland's emissions by 2050. Britain's just signed up to Paris. I assume that's in line with what your governments have agreed.
You mean 2020?
Hmm? Sorry, by 2020, a 50% reduction by 2020 compared with 1990. Thank you very much for that. 75% cut by 2025, a 90% cut by 2030, and a completely decarbonised energy system for Ireland by 2035, the same for the UK, for the EU, for the US. This is for an outside chance of 2 degrees centigrade that we all know will be very destructive to poorer people elsewhere on the planet and probably affect very significantly people living even in Ireland. In a globalised world, we will not be here isolated and insulated from these sorts of impacts. So this is for an outside chance of 2 degrees C. Why are we not hearing this? Why is this not the language you currently hear? What's wrong with the maths? I've given these talks all over the place. No one ever comes back and says there's something wrong with the maths. Broadly, these results, I think, hold. The EU submission, so in other words, the Irish submission or the UK submission to Paris was a 40% reduction by 2030, less than half that is necessary for 2 degrees centigrade. How can this be reconciled with official accounts? This is taken from Working Group 3, an economist who heads up Working Group 3, based in Berlin. Mitigation costs would be so low that global economic growth would not be strongly affected. Now, we all want to hear that, because that's, of course, what we have to abide by, because it's more important than the second law of thermodynamics. So we're all aiming to achieve growth regardless of the physics around it. If you go to the UK, to keep to 2 degrees C, we need an 80% cut by 2050, where you can argue about that. The good news is that cuts or reductions of that size are possible without sacrificing the benefits of economic growth and rising prosperity. So Osborne likes that. We all like this. You know, the climate science community likes this because we can carry on doing what we're doing. Everyone likes this message. But how can you possibly reconcile this with the sorts of numbers I was just showing before for an outside chance of 2 degrees centigrade when we've signed up to stay well below 2 degrees C and aim for 1.5? And where's the hole in this? The reason I think that we have managed to reconcile these two to salve our consciences is we are first using negative emission technologies, BECCS, biomass energy carbon capture and storage being the most popular of these, and this dominates the integrated assessment models that feed in to the IPCC, or in the UK, feed directly in to advice from the Committee on Climate Change to the government. This means basically growing biomass of one sort or another, trees, plants, whatever they might be, switchgrass, miscanthus, willow. That as it grows, as these things grow, they will absorb carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. We then chip these, convert them into some convenient form of fuel pellets or whatever, transport it all around the world in ships, burn it in our power stations, capture the carbon dioxide going up the chimney, or at least some of it, with a very large piece of equipment that we bolt on the back end of our power station. We compress, almost liquefy to a phase change state the carbon dioxide, and then we pump it underground and store it there for 1,000 years or so. Now, does that sound in any way reasonable? And I sort of made the comment the other day, we're doing that because we can't be bothered to find a way of transporting 70 to 100 kilograms of flesh 6 miles to pick up some groceries without attaching to them 1,000 kilograms of car. You know, think of the things that we've normalized in our life. And instead of making changes to those things, we're going to do this. This has never worked at scale. We have no examples of this working, you know, even at the micro scale. There are massive technical and economic unknowns. It simply just may not work, and it'd be very costly. There's a huge efficiency penalty. If it does work at scale, it'd be a 15 to 25% efficiency penalty on the back end of a power station that runs at between 35 and 55% efficient. So this is a very unsophisticated grunt way of dealing with the problem. Limited biomass availability. Everyone wants biomass. Everyone's relying on it as their silver bullet. Aviation's going to be flying on biomass. Shipping's going to be using biomass. 5 to 7% of EU fuel uses biomass. I think that's correct in the cars. We've got to feed 9.7 billion people, depending on where you look at the UN projections, from the planet as well. And beyond that, you've got the chemical industry wants biomass for the chemical feedstock. And you've got to have your fingers crossed on the feedbacks, that whilst you put this wonderful bit of kit in place with all the infrastructure, that we won't be hit by the feedbacks of ongoing emissions, relatively high levels of emissions. Things like the melting of the permafrost, the increased emissions of methane being the most obvious example of these feedbacks. If you look at the IPCC scenarios for a reasonable chance of 2 degrees centigrade, then they pretty much all assume you're going to plant out somewhere the size of 1 to 3 times the area of India. So we're not talking about a small planting regime. We are talking about huge levels of planting. You're going to do this year after year, decade after decade. You're going to suck hundreds of billions of tons of carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and then store it underground somewhere securely for 1,000 years or so. Now, we do not have the oil and gas reservoirs for this. So beyond that, you're looking at saline aquifers. And recent work has shown that actually, if you go to the saline aquifers, they may not be secure places for the carbon dioxide. So there are lots of issues about this, where there's enough resources out there to store it, and even if you could, whether in fact it may then start to leak. But that all looks quite straightforward compared with the second rabbit in the hat, which is that we have to travel back in time. And I said before, that it sounds flippant, but it's not. We don't have a time machine. None of us have successfully done this. So why is that embedded in what you think would be completely reasoned and rational approaches for scientists to guide governments? Well, let's look at the IPCC scenario database. There are 400 scenarios in there, of emission scenarios, for a 50% chance or better of 2 degrees C. Of those, 86% assume negative emission technologies will work. The other 14% assume we peak global emissions in 2010 or thereabouts. And about Well, the majority, I think it's about 70% of the scenarios for 50% chance or better from the IPCC scenario database, assume both negative emissions and that we can peak emissions in 2010. Yeah, that's what underpins the Paris Agreement. That's what underpins the UK government's Committee on Climate Change advice to the British government about its carbon budgets. So I would suggest that this is a good example of how we are massaging and fine-tuning our analysis, or our assumptions rather, to deliver something that most of us know deep down is misguided and misleading, but it keeps us all happy in between. It is a collective delusion of all of us that work in this area. So Paris, many academics, most of them, well, all of us to some degree, politicians, rather than focus on urgent and deep mitigation now, because that has huge challenging political and economic repercussions, we're relying on non-existent negative emission technologies in years to come to suck CO2 out of the air. That's what we are collectively doing as a rational 20th century society. So I go back to Richard Feynman. For successful technology, reality must take precedence over public relations, for nature cannot be fooled. I think we are very clearly trying to fool nature. So I think that, you know, we should take note of what he had to say and revisit our position and have greater scientific integrity and not really care too much about the political sensibilities within which we will have to guide their policies. So let's go back to 2 degrees centigrade. Is it still a viable goal? Well, I've said yes. So now we get to some more upbeat stuff. So this is all fairly depressing, I think, up till now. But I still think 2 degrees C is a viable goal. Otherwise, I wouldn't work on climate change. And there are three things here that I think are important, but only two I'm going to touch on now. First is on equity and behavior. The second is on technology. And the third one, which I'm not going to go into, is this idea of growth. And we can maybe discuss that later. But the idea of green growth, the sort of things that come out of the new climate, new economy report from Stern, which has, of course, no reference to 2 degrees centigrade and no reference to carbon budgets within it. The win-win sort of arguments we repeatedly hear at a collective level. These will not deliver 2 degrees centigrade. At a collective level, these are not viable. Now, that doesn't mean to say in some sectors, in some particular parts of the community, the poor parts of the community, we can see improvements in quality of life and so forth. But aggregate, particularly across the wealthier parts of the world, they are not compatible with anything like our commitments in Paris. But I'm not going to talk about those now. I'm going to focus here on equity. Let's think first that 50% of global CO2 emissions come from 10% of the population. You know, they're hugely skewed towards a group of people like me and others. We are the people that are responsible for most emissions. That's taken from the Chancellor and Piketty paper that came out last year on extreme carbon inequality, and also was followed up later by Oxfam report during the COP. Just think about what that means. Who are the high emitters? So once you know that, it's a really useful bit of data. I think if you're a government, you think, right, 50% from just 10% of the population, that's probably something very similar in Ireland. Let's aim our policies at them. We think, well, yeah, we need to change their behaviour. Who are they? Well, climate scientists. So if you're a climate scientist, you'll spend most of your life on a plane flying to another essential conference. So we need to be thinking very seriously about how we lead our lives. No doubt we'll make the excuse that our message is more important than the emissions, but then everyone else says that as well. So I've not come across anyone that doesn't say that, whether it's the business community, the policymakers, the NGOs, or the scientists. I put a question mark on that one. I mean, are people in the RIA in that group? I guess it's probably most of you are, or aspiring to be there. If you take an annual flight, is it a long-haul flight or two every year, if you're someone that regularly finds yourself on a plane, then you're going to be in that category, almost certainly, because it's partly sort of emblematic of the way that we, people that do this sort of thing, live our lives, their high-carbon lives. 2 degrees centigrade is a mitigation, is an issue about the short term. It's about what we do between now and 2025. However much politicians may want to park it in the long grass of 2030 and 2050, the science tells us for 2 degrees centigrade, it's what we do now that matters. It is a consumption problem, not a population problem. The poor will not become wealthy enough in the time frame we have to deal with 2 degrees centigrade for their emissions to matter. It only matters about those of us that emit a lot today. Now, that's not only in the West, that includes 300 million people in China who emit like the average European, but 1 billion people don't. And about 300 million people in China, I think, are on $1.25 a day, very low emissions. So the high emitters. Now, there's a really brutal logic in this, which I used this slide this afternoon, actually. And very uncomfortable. I've done this, used it as well with quite a few of my other colleagues. And if you can find a way around it, please let me know, because I'd like to change my behavior on these things. Let's think about aviation, which is symptomatic of the sorts of problems that we are facing. at the high, particularly very high carbon end. For every tonne of carbon dioxide that we emit when we go flying, remember, those of us that fly are already very high emitters. We might like to think it's the poor that are driving aviation growth, but that's, you know, any look at the data tells us that's not true. Aviation growth is driven by frequent flyers who have incomes that are twice above the median for most of the countries that are frequently flying. For every tonne of carbon dioxide that we put into the atmosphere is a tonne that poorer communities cannot emit if you've got a set carbon budget. Now, is there a way out of that? You've got a set carbon budget. If we pump in lots more than we reasonably should, as an individual, from flying or whatever it might be, then others can't do it. And who will they be? They'll be the poor. Or they carry on doing it and we exceed 2 degrees centigrade. But for a set carbon budget, you're stuck with that. And we also know that the poor, and there's very clear evidence for this, the poor have very significant improvements in the quality of life if they have better access to energy. And in the short term, that means access probably to fossil fuel energy as well as hopefully renewables. That means their emissions will go up. So if we're going to carry on flying, we're effectively telling them they can't do that. We also know that for us, if you look at the indicators for quality of life, and there are numerous ways of looking at that, that actually our increased use of energy makes no difference to our quality of life. Above a certain sweet spot, you don't get any improvement, and we're well above that sweet spot. So when we decide to go to a conference somewhere, as we got on a plane, it's a really difficult choice between going to a conference, visiting a family member, going on holiday, whatever it might be, and others' access to energy for basic needs. So it's that blunt. That's what the science tells us if we want to abide by our politically derived 2 degrees C targets. And if you can find a way around that, then let me know, because I'm quite keen to start flying again. I'm going to talk on technology. As an engineer, this is what I really rely on to try and get us out of a lot of these problems, but it's not enough, but it certainly will help. I'm talking here about the demand side technology, just on petrols and then petrol cars and diesel cars, and then briefly on refrigerators, which I'll just touch on. Ireland's emissions are somewhere between 15 and 20% from land transport. There are about 300 models of current cars available that have carbon dioxide emissions that are less than 100 grams per kilometre. The average car driving past out here will be about 165, 170 grams. The average car being sold in Ireland will be about 130 grams, very similar to the UK, 212, 220 grams in the US, and probably 170 plus grams in Germany. So there are lots of cars available now. These have no price premium. They cover every single category except for sports SUV. And they can take three seats in the back. So they're just the normal sorts of vehicles that we see on the road. And we know that 2/3 of all car travel is traveled by cars that are 8 years old or younger. So we very, very rapidly change out the fleet. So if you were to decide to have a maximum CO2 standard, if we were to decide to have a maximum CO2 standard for existing petrol and diesel cars, with no additional capital cost, the cars cost no more money than the normal car, than the average car. A reduced operating cost, we have to buy a lot less fuel. Identical infrastructure, same roads, same petrol stations, same employers, same companies make the cars. You know, the BMW and Volkswagen make both the efficient and the inefficient ones. You would have something like a 50 to 70% reduction in emissions from this very intractable sector in 10 years, and all you require is a spine in our policymakers and the strike of a pen. And with that, we could put policies in place. Now, we don't, because we've got Jeremy Clarkson in the UK and we've got the Daily Mail. But you know, there's no reason why we couldn't be making these transitions very rapidly. And yet we choose, because climate change is not that important to us, really, if we were honest about it, not to do these things. Refrigeration is the same thing here. A-rated, A++ refrigerator uses, according to DEC, 80% less energy than an A-rated refrigerator. Phase them out, you get a 50% reduction in one of the major consumers of energy in our households after hot water and heating. Which is refrigeration and freezing. 50% reduction or thereabouts, 40 to 60, in about 10 years. So these are things we can do with existing technologies. We can do them immediately, and we're choosing not to. So if we are serious about climate change, we need a radical plan to move us in the right direction. We need to dramatically reduce the energy demand of those of us who are high emitters, and we know who they are. We see them when we shave or put our makeup on in the mornings. We need a massive Marshall Plan for moving to zero carbon, not low carbon, zero carbon energy. If we're serious about stabilising temperature, it's got to be zero, not low. And that has to be done across the globe by 2050. This is for an outside chance of 2 degrees centigrade, of what we've signed, an outside chance of what we've signed up to in Paris, which of course was a very good chance of 2 degrees centigrade. Some thoughts for Ireland, and these are very simplistic thoughts from someone who doesn't live here. So you know, there may well be things you can question about them. There are 1.7 million homes here. 1.2 million of those will be here in 2050. So why not retrofit them? If you retrofit them, it's going to cost, I've used here and I've had that verified by someone yesterday, about 40,000 euros per house to retrofit, a deep retrofit. That's 48 billion euros. Do that over 15 years, that's about 3 billion euros a year. That's about 1.3% of your GDP. So that sounds quite pricey. Except what do you get for that? You get really good training and massive unemployment for people who are relatively low skilled. You have 9% unemployed. Probably most of those are low skilled. They could have jobs. They could no longer be requiring unemployment benefit and all the health issues that go with that. They could have jobs retrofitting their houses that you have in Ireland. Oh, and we have the same argument in the UK as well. You would eliminate fuel poverty. That's 200 to 300,000 homes. Their kids would no longer have bronchial problems from the spores of fungus in their damp homes. You would make those houses resilient to a changing climate, and you would make the houses also, or the occupants, resilient to volatile fuel prices, because now their fuel prices would be very low. You get about a 70% reduction if you did it well, maybe higher in the emissions from those properties. Introduce a maximum CO2 standard for all your vehicles and move towards electrification. My understanding is, I've been told quite a few times, that you have a very good charging system or charging appliances around Ireland, but you don't see any electric cars. So you've got the appliances there for charging them, but you don't have the cars. You've got the stations for charging them. So we need to have a big increase in electric cars. Why not make sure that all public sector vehicles that are purchased now that can be electrics and not maybe HGVs and so forth are electric? So you lead by example. Stringent efficiency standards on all electrical equipment. Start with government procurement. You could be doing that with everything that we buy. And I think we need to be pushing the EU to make sure that all our standards are along the lines of the top run approach in Japan. I recommend looking at what they've done in Japan over many decades now. So if you did all of that, I think you could power down the energy system in the wealthy parts of the world by about 40 to 70% in about 15 years. Now that sounds ridiculous, but it depends whether we think climate change is a serious issue. My guess is most of us don't. But we could make that reduction if we thought it was really that important. The supply side, a huge electrification program. 80% of the energy we consume is not electric. And actually it's very hard to imagine what that would be that would be low carbon. Biomass, biofuels, if you can get it sustainable and low carbon, or hydrogen, which would probably be produced through electrolysis anyway, maybe thermal decomposition. But you're talking about really having to electrify the energy system. And that means the grid has to be, even if you powered down the demand, would still have to be probably somewhere in the region of twice to three times bigger than it is today. Roll out smart grids, intelligent metering, community energy, and all those good things that help us deal with intermittency to one degree or another. Phase out your peat stations. You know, one of the wealthiest countries in Europe, one of the most educated countries in the world, is burning peat in power stations. You're a very wealthy nation. You are very well educated. You've got a huge renewable potential. You're very much like the UK, only slightly better educated, you know, and slightly wealthier per capita. You know, you're the same as Norway in that sense. So why is it we're not using our renewable potential? Why are we not using the things that we have around us that allow us to move to very low carbon energy fairly rapidly? Why are we not doing that at anything like the sort of pace we would need? Put solar panels on your southwest facing roofs and homes here, which would not be that pricey. That will generate one third of your current electricity demand, there or thereabouts. Now it will be intermittent, but it's very reliable on a yearly basis. You know exactly what the price will be over the year, and you know pretty much how much you're going to get over the year. So it's much more reliable in terms of a price than it is for any of the fossil fuels. And think about indigenous biogas and biomass. Now I've been told this isn't quite so viable for Ireland. You know, I'll take people at their word on that. It'd be interesting to look at that in a bit more detail, but that might help us overcome some of the intermittency issues. But they are much less than intermittency issues than most people think on renewables. Once you've got cars on the grid, heating on the grid, once you've got demand side management, intelligent metering and so forth, you significantly reduce the intermittency issues. So some policy issues, progressive metering tariffs. We have a rebound effect. When we're energy efficient, we spend the money that we save on jet skis and holidays. So our emissions just don't go down overall. So we have to go beyond efficiency. We have to find ways to stop people using the money they save just to spend more energy, spend things with more energy in them. Now that's not true for the poorer. We want those people to actually improve the quality of their lives, and that does mean that their energy consumption will go up. But if we have progressive metering tariffs, the price goes up, the more you consume, that helps the equity issue, and it helps the rest of us avoid the rebound effect. Stringent efficiency standards across the board. A moratorium on hydrocarbon developments. You should not be developing here your offshore oil and gas industry, and you should not be developing any fracking. And nor should the UK. We should be closing ours down and using our expertise to build offshore wind turbines and other, you know, the tidal power scheme in the Severn. So you should be using the expertise for doing things that are low carbon. Have a moratorium on airport expansion. Challenging for an island, but you know, we're an island in the UK. It's difficult. But we have to do that again if we're serious about climate change. Adopt a low discount rate. The Treasury book in the UK, the Green Book, has a 3.5% discount rate. That fundamentally changes investment opportunities. It makes, for instance, onshore wind turbines considerably cheaper than combined cycle gas turbines, because it actually says the future costs matter. As if you use a high discount rate, it doesn't care about the costs after about 5 years. And I put this in brackets, it's not my area, but very clearly in Ireland, you have, I think it is about a third of your emissions are from agriculture. That sector has to be dealt with. You cannot solve climate change with the world reckoning it's got these special sectors. Aviation's special, shipping's special. You know, people think their countries are special. You know, every sector's got to reduce. So we think about agriculture here, it needs to have emission reductions that are dramatic, real and absolute. Not just about efficiency, it's absolute reductions in greenhouse gas emissions. Challenge for science and academia. We should always be scientifically robust, but with some humility that we will from time to time get things wrong. We need to be transparent in our analysis, vociferous about our conclusions, disregard political sensibilities and vested interests. They are not our interest when we work in universities. If you're academics or scientists working this, it doesn't matter whether people like or dislike your conclusions. It doesn't matter whether it's challenging for them with their policies. Our job as scientists is to inform them about our analysis clearly and bluntly. So we should be advocates for scientific integrity and for very clear communication. And that is our role in informing a shift towards a 2°C energy system and indeed society more generally. So on that final slide, thanks for listening.